There's a lot of talk about the valley disrupting the street. You know, fintech and everything, the technology industry is disrupting every industry, disrupting financial services. You epitomize the street disrupting the valley. You went there a year ago, and I have to ask, kind of what's the culture shock? You know, you think of Wall Street, suits, you don't think flip-flops. What was the biggest shock about heading west?
Well, the biggest shock wasn't getting to wear blue jeans and free food and all the cool things that we actually do, but it was how early stage Google is. And that's an odd thing to say when you think about our size, but when you just start going product by product, as I had the opportunity to look under the hood, you know, on mobile, you think about how the way we use our handsets is just continuing to evolve. We talk about these micro moments now. And when you combine what we're doing with geo data and the ability to be where you are with what you need when you need it, just the utility is continuing to explode. When you think about voice search, now 20% of searches in the US are voice search. For the next 4 billion who come online, it'll probably all be voice search. So that's new. And then you look at YouTube, and we have more 18 to 49-year-olds watching YouTube video on mobile than on any cable or network station, and yet the offline ad dollars are still larger than what we're seeing online. So that has to move over. And then you look at VR and you look at the cloud, and it's kind of one thing after another, life sciences, self-driving cars.
So there's endless possibilities. Yes. But let's just stick a second with the culture, because there has to be a difference in culture. I mean, when I go to Wall Street, it's a lot of boring white men in suits. When I go to Silicon Valley, it's a slightly different.
Well, so the big culture difference is there really is this, at least at Google Alphabet, this very mission-oriented, how can I make the lives of billions of people better? It's okay to fail. We have an entire area within our Moonshot Factory X where we try and fail. Our view is if we can kill something before someone else can, we're better off. And there's a whole celebration around failing. Because that means that we've saved the resources and we can put them on to the next one. And so I described it to someone that there's a lightness about working in Silicon Valley, and that guy now works with us because he immediately made the move. And it is very mission-oriented.
I guess one set of people who might not celebrate failing are the people you have to talk to on your quarterly earnings calls. I mean, you came in part, you understand the discipline of Wall Street, you were CFO of Morgan Stanley, you're now CFO of a company that has, you know, founded by engineers, a moonshot company. Do you find yourself being the disciplinarian there?
Well, I hate that term, and it is used quite often. I think the main thing that with investors and analysts, and it kind of goes to your short-termism point, and is discipline part of short-termism? I think the most important element is to have a true north. And I would say that for politicians, I think it's for business leaders, I think the greatest leaders have a true north, and they know what you're driving for. And with us, it goes back to your first comment, it is about creating a long-term, durable, responsible organization. And I often say that we have been and remain committed to long-term revenue growth. Whenever I'm asked about expenses, that's my first answer, committed to and have been long-term revenue growth. And I often quote Larry in his founder's letter back in 2013. He made the comment that incrementalism leads to irrelevance, in particular in technology where change is revolutionary, not evolutionary. And I was actually quoting that when I was back at Morgan Stanley, because I think there's a lot of wisdom in it for all industries. And if you believe that, then you can't deal, you've got to look at expenses in that context. My goal is to ensure that we get the best return on the resources we're putting behind any opportunity. It's about making sure we're managing it appropriately, but with this long-term view that the way to build a long-term sustainable company is by investing for the long term.
But isn't part of it also creating a structure that investors can understand, so they understand what your long-term mission is? Because, and I'm sure this was not a coincidence, pretty soon around your arrival, Google became Alphabet, and we have a different structure now for the company. Why did you do that, and was that part of making it easier for the investors to understand what was going on?
So the seeds of it do go back to, I think, the many comments made, such as, incrementalism leads to irrelevance. And in fact, when we were sitting around the table that Sunday prior to announcing Alphabet, I reminded Larry of that statement, that I've been quoting it for years because I think it's so profound. And we now have an organizational structure that really mirrors that ambition, where we've said we are going to continue to invest appropriately in moonshots, because if you think of Google as continuing to have this strong growth, it's our responsibility to build today to layer on those next kind of growth engines within the Alphabet family. And so this structure gives us the focus within Google, the focus within the other bets, and the ability, therefore, to run them as effectively as possible and to have transparency internally and externally about how much we're investing in each of the businesses.
And is that, is the discipline of the quarterly earnings calls of being a public company, is that a good thing, or is it something that is, you know, are you constrained by, and it's people often say it, by the short-termism of Wall Street?
Yeah, I don't think it's a good thing. I think that, again, it goes back to my comment that you do as a leader have to have a true north. I just finished a couple of days of investor meetings, and in each one I'm asked, well, why don't you give us incrementally more information here or do something else that's short-term oriented? And my very strong view is that whatever you do that short-term may feel good for them in the moment, but they will want something more. And if they don't feel you have a true north, at the end of the day, you're going to lose in any event. And so the conversation with investors is, I appreciate why you want it. What you'd really love is to have our full model. But what we're trying to do is build a business that delivers the best returns for all of our stakeholders over the longer term. And we need to make trade-offs. And oftentimes, those trade-offs are, we certainly should give you clarity about our direction. You need to understand how we think. Context can be really valuable. But some of the very short-term steps that investors may think they want don't drive long-term value. And that's why I keep coming. I think when you oblige, it feels good in the short term, and then there's concern that you actually don't have a true north.
So you absolutely have to have the longer
I think
term.
You absolutely have to, and we're very clear about it, which is why when you said expenses, my immediate response was we're focused on long-term revenue growth. We have been and will continue to be. And I think that's what builds the types of institutions that are important. You cannot be swayed by short-term pressures.
Talking of being swayed by short-term pressures, I want to take you back to the financial crisis. You were there, a very senior player in the biggest crisis that American capitalism had since the 1930s. What lessons did you learn from that? And particularly, did you learn lessons that are applicable now as you're in this very different environment?
So during the financial crisis, I was actually running Morgan Stanley's financial institutions group, responsible for all banks and insurance companies, asset managers, and was asked by Secretary of the Treasury Hank Paulson at the time to lead a team to advise the US government on the housing crisis, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac. And then that bled right into the AIG, played a role with advising the Federal Reserve on AIG. That was the most terrifying moment of the crisis. And the lessons that I got, there are many, but probably the two most important were, first, any institution, no matter how strong, can fail if it does not have appropriate dashboards, financial metrics, risk analytics. And to me, the metaphor is you would not drive a car at 100 miles an hour with mud all over the windshield. And that's what companies were doing back then. That's what banks and insurance companies were doing. After Lehman weekend, I was down at the Federal Reserve, and I went home, and I literally got a call at about 7 p.m. that Sunday night from the Treasury, and they said, we worked on the wrong thing. AIG will be out of money by Wednesday. They'll be out of liquidity, out of cash by Wednesday, which I initially thought was a really bad joke. And they said, no, it's not. We need you to come back down. And we literally worked Monday through Tuesday. And in the middle of the night, it was clear that AIG would not make it through Tuesday. And the problem was, as we all know now, this derivatives hedge fund essentially here in the UK, nobody knew what was going on. The company didn't know, the regulators didn't know. They were driving at 100 miles an hour with mud all over the windshield. And it was the most terrifying part of the crisis, because what you could feel sitting there was the oxygen coming out of the financial system. And my fear, and I think for all of us, was that individuals and small businesses would be so badly damaged, and there was no way they could have planned for it. So that was absolutely one of the important messages that, to me, is true for any industry. You have to see where you're going. The other one was also from Hank Paulson. One point in the crisis, he said to me, you have to have the will and you have to have the means. And too often, by the time you have the will, you no longer have the means. And I, you know, he's talking about the US crisis, that if you think about Greece, if we had dealt with it really early, all of that pain in the 2010, 11, 12 period could have been very different. But we did not have the will, and by the time we did, it was much more difficult. And I actually think that's even true in an extraordinary growth company like Alphabet. Because if we just go through budgeting and we've got the means and we just spray everything everywhere and we don't make tough choices, by the time we say, you know, we need to make those choices, we've actually wasted valuable resources. And so I talk a lot about the importance of prioritization, working with business leaders to understand amongst all of the things they can do, where do they want to prioritize those valuable resources? And I, to me, it goes very much back to Hank, you have to have the will and the means.
Do you think that as a society, as an economy, we've learned the right lessons from the financial crisis? You look back now and you reminded me of, it was a much lesser, I was in a much lesser role observing this, but it was a really, really frightening time.
Terrifying.
Really terrifying. You really felt, and I'm sure many of you who are watching this, you know, it was a time when you thought we are collapsing into the 1930s again. It was a very, very scary moment. But as time passes and the scariness of it is sort of recedes, do you think as a society we've learned the right lessons? We've put the safeguards in place, we've created a safer financial system?
I think we've created in the US a safer financial system. We've so fundamentally changed the amount of capital and liquidity and the activities that banks can do. And my concern at this point is we've so vilified banks that they've become the symbol of everything wrong, when in fact there are still issues we need to deal with, but it's not all within one system or within one industry. And so I think to that narrow part of your question we have, but there's still many places where we haven't. So one example, an area I'm concerned about in the US is our federal student lending program. It's broken a trillion four at this point. And to me, it's exactly like the housing problem in that we had a very well-intentioned social program. In the 60s, it was affordable housing. Today, it's education. Who could argue that education isn't a passport for life? The problem is in the US, we're putting about $120 billion a year into student loans. And a large percent of these kids are going to for-profit colleges. About two-thirds of them don't graduate in 6 years, so they're left with the bill and no degree. And you look at that and say, there's only one thing that's gonna happen. It's what we saw in the housing crisis. We're gonna have default rates going up. And in fact, over the last several years, you have seen default rates going up. So we just have to be very careful when we're trying to address a problem that we're addressing it honestly, directly, and at the root cause. And so I think there are still areas, I feel very strongly that one of the important things that we all need to do is play a role in solving some of these issues. One of the key ones in the States and globally is unemployment, clearly. And what do you do with youth unemployment and those who are displaced in their 50s and 60s? And for us, a big part of that is job training. We spend a ton of time at Google on computer science training, training people for the digital economy. We're going to be training 2 million people here in Europe this year, by the end of this year, to be ready for the digital economy. So I think every company has to look at how it can play its part in solving these issues.
That's interesting. That gets to a subject I wanted to address, which is the whole question of reputation. Mm-hmm. You know, Wall Street, where you came from, as you said, bankers are vilified. Wall Street has a terrible reputation. I think on Neil Ferguson's chart, it was only barely above Congress. You know, people loathe bankers. Do you think people generally love tech companies? Although in Europe, actually, not entirely true that big tech is not always a positive statement here. Do you think there is a risk that tech companies could become the banks of the future in the sense of public reputation?
Well, we start with products that people love and use every day and are delighted every day with, whether it's your Google search or your photos, whatever it is. And so that's a good starting point. But we are very focused internally And people are here because they feel they're part of a mission, which is to make the lives of millions of people better every day. But then the question we often challenge ourselves with is, how more can we use our skills and our technology to improve the lives of those who aren't as fortunate? And so, you know, our Growth Engines initiative is one example of that. Training in computer science skills is another example. I happened to get an email from a colleague this morning. We just won an award back in California for job training for those who are long-term structurally unemployed, and all of the effort we're putting behind it. And so I think, again, it's about ensuring that you're using your differentiated skills to
And is to there help more that issues. You should do, that Google Alphabet should do, that the tech sector should do? I'm struck by the challenge earlier, I think it was Neil Ferguson again, this time it was addressed to politicians, but one or to the elites, to everybody here, you know. Were the elites doing enough to address the concerns of the either the displaced worker or indeed the worker, the non-elite person right. who feels that their living standards have stagnated? You've laid out some of the things you're doing. Do you think there is more that this community should be doing?
Well, I think that many of the comments this morning on the election, I share the concerns. And the concern about, it's an abomination, for lack of a better word. What are we trying to do there is, I think information is really powerful. And that, of course, is core to the mission of Google, is making information available. So many of the assertions, you know, the assertion, make America great again. Well, what are the issues and how tangibly are we going to address some of the policy concerns? So we're trying to make sure that information is broadly available. We're also trying to do things to make sure that actually there are not obstacles to voting. So using technology to ensure that you can help people get out to vote. They know where to register, when to register, and I think those are valuable steps that can be part of what is less about a substantive debate at this point, but hopefully we'll move into one.
And a scary time. Let's turn to something positive before we end. With the next session after us, we're going to be hearing from some brilliant innovators, and innovators particularly in Europe who are entrepreneurs who are growing fast. What's your sense of the role of finance and the role of the CFO in a fast-growing tech entrepreneurial company? And for everybody out here, you know, how important is their CFO and what is their role?
Obviously very important. I think it goes back to my lesson from the financial crisis that you need to build your systems and controls ahead of requirements. And for fast-growing technology companies, by the time you know you need it, you're well ahead of what you probably have in place. So you always have to be ahead of the curve. But I think probably the most important lesson from the tech experience in the 90s is make sure you have a differentiated edge in your business. And what happened back then is there were too many companies who were able to get funding, who were looking at the internet as a distribution channel, but there really wasn't anything that was truly differentiated. It was like an online catalog, and that was the debate we often had with many of the companies. So ask yourself, challenge yourself, if you're putting resources behind something, what is the true differentiated strength, technical or business model?
I have to ask from that. So has there been too much easy money going into the tech sector? Has there been a bubble?
Well, I think that there are a couple of differences between now and in the 90s, which is one, the sheer reach of the online experience and the number of people who are online and continue to be online. But there are areas where it certainly seemed to be getting ahead of itself, and this correction here, this recalibration, this reset is probably a healthy thing.
And if you cast your mind back to when you started on Wall Street, if you were making your career choice now, would you be going to Silicon Valley or would you be going to Wall Street?
Well, I wouldn't be here but for the fact that I did that. So I think the training was extremely valuable. One of my go-to interview questions is, what are your battle scars? And I think that battle scars actually give you the ability to prevent hitting that wall at 100 miles an hour. You actually have pattern recognition that is super valuable. And so kind of going through the trenches, I'm really glad that I did. And I think those types of experiences merged with the extraordinary, optimistic entrepreneurs that we have in the company provides for the strongest kind of partnership.
And so, Valley meets street, you need both of them together.
Well, value is a, that's a...
Valley.
Oh, valley, thank you. Yes, valley meets street. There are skills that you can get from a lot of different places, and the notion of battle scars, I would say, look for it in your teams, because that pattern recognition can help you build ahead of requirements, and that's valuable.
Ruth, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Thank you.